I'm sorry?
It's a man I've been talking about.
Oh, okay. I thought somebody was asking a question. I wanted to make sure. Okay. All right. And for those of you who are still getting your HSW continuing education credit through the American Institute of Architects, this tour is for 1 hour credit. So after the tour, if you need that credit, come see me and I will make sure that you get the proper credit from our agency official who takes care of that. There's a lot more to be said. Obviously, that's why you're all here. But it was designed by George Mann and Eugene John Sherm in the Spanish Revival style. You can see all the Spanish Revival influences here. And even for those of us who have a lot of experience in architecture or in those like me who have learned more about architectural styles in the past year than I have ever known in my life. But it's based on the Spanish colonial architecture of the Spanish colonization of the Americas, and it was particularly common in this part of the country up to the end of the 1920s. The Panama, California Exposition of 1915 in San Diego would highlight the work of architect Bertram Goodhue, and he is credited with giving the style national exposure. It was embraced particularly in California and Florida, and of course if you vacation out there, you've seen numerous examples of this. Spanish colonial revival style enjoyed its greatest popularity in the United States between 1915 and 1931. It coincides with the Great Depression and certainly a move away from very elaborate styles. Basic and reflecting the economic and social realities of the time. Now, although the hotel was completed in 1929, just before the stock market crash and the onset of the depression, the Albert Pike Hotel's ornate interior spaces do reflect the extravagance of the Roaring Twenties, even if the hotel and its residents never particularly experienced that extravagance. The hotel cost approximately $1 million to build, which was considered extremely extravagant in that era in Arkansas, even before the Depression. And today, it would cost $14 million to construct. Raise your hand if you think anybody can build this hotel today for $14 million. I didn't think so. And this building was placed on the National Register on the 21st of November, 1978. Now, before the Albert Pike was built, the home of Robert Crittenden was located on this site, built in 1827 and torn down in 1920. Just raise your hand if you are familiar with Mr. Robert Crittenden. Okay? Well, Robert Crittenden was kind of what you would call today even the market. So it was completed, however, in 1924, not long before the hotel was. And it was also the staff of George Van and Gene John Stern, and was built to house the expanded membership of the ancient and extended Scottish Rite of Freemasonry in Arkansas during the early 20th century. In fact, it's kind of ironic that one of the greatest periods of growth for Freemasonry in Arkansas also coincided with the growth spurt of the second Ku Klux Klan. Now, what kind of irony do you find there? Okay?
Entrances. You again, you're able to see this.
And you had them also here, behind us on the rear walls. And then various incarnations of these also you'll find throughout the building and when you go upstairs. Okay? The remaining first floor windows and doors have cast stacked stone surrounds with some detail. And all the windows from the third floor up have been replaced. In the late 1950s, a two-story addition was built on the south side of the hotel. And the bottom floor is called London Hall and serves as storage for Catering Creations, which is a catering company that operates out of the outer Pike Hotel. In fact, it operates right here out of what was originally the restaurant. The nice suites are above London Hall. The rooms in this addition were patterned after the original Holiday Inn models. It basically did a little poaching off of Kenneth Wilson. The windows and doors on the upper floor were once all glass. And a diamond-shaped swimming pool and a fountain was built in the grassy area in the 1950s as well, but they had been built in recent years. A two-story parking garage just right behind us, the east, was built in 1929. And at that time had 100 car capacity and featured the cast stone detailing along the vehicle entrance with the words Albert Pike Garage engraved above the door. It still had the original multi-bay hopper windows, but it was cut pointed and had some coping replaced in 1986. And of course, if you noticed, if you came in from this end, you noticed that that is not necessarily used for hotel or public parking anymore, as it is closed off by a warehouse type door. The hotel was operated by the Southwest Hotels Group, and then it was purchased by the Second Baptist Church in December 1971. A proclamation became a residential facility. It's been that way ever since. The church, as per its initial announcement, and this is their quote, they sought to provide, quote, a family retirement community that was happy and uplifting. In 1976, the hotel received a Section 234 loan from the Department of Housing and Urban Development for infrastructure improvements. The building was sold to the Albert Pike Residence Hotel Limited in 1986, which was a group of investors from Jonesboro, particularly led by Philip Jones. And it continued upgrades in the interior, including the restoration of the North Lounge, which is in this area, in 1994. And the North Lounge is normally not open to the public. It is normally rented out for meetings and other special events. It provides a common activities room, which is up here in front in the old lounge there to your left. And television lounge, post office boxes, and libraries. In May of 2013, BSR Trust Photolock and Montgomery, Alabama completed the purchase on what is a 130-unit apartment building. Empire Corporation of Knoxville, Tennessee was hired to perform further renovations to the property. The bottom floor that you're at right now, particularly here in the ballroom, is rented out for special events, and Catering Creations operates out of the restaurant area, which also doubles as a dining hall for the current residents who live here. Regular events are held to inform residents of health and community services available in the area, as well as weekly bingo, monthly birthday parties, and special occasion and holiday parties. It's a very multifaceted facility still as far as its current use is concerned. The upper floors are rented out as apartments, basically everything above the second floor. There are currently the north lobby, the interior, of course, you'll be able to see the top two floors when you go upstairs. But the north lobby, the interior of these floors is entirely original, with the exception of a few things on the mezzanine level that were destroyed in two fires, both in October 2007 and February 2008. The wood panel ceilings in the north lobby area feature diamond-shaped projections, and again, they're another common feature throughout the building. The brass panel and elevator doors bear the outer pipe shield in each panel and are surrounded by glazed tile. The letter box and the mail chute were originally installed in the hotel in 1929, even though the mail chute has not worked for years. There's basically pieces of masonry and other debris that have fallen off in the chute and jammed into it, so it rendered it inoperable. However, the mail box still works and it is still considered an official United States mail facility. The shield design also appears in the same glass window above the door to the parking garage. This design was replicated on the building signage in 2000 and 2001. Both the elevators were replaced in 1995, but the doors you will see there are still original from 1929. The first and second floors have water fountains and glazed tiles, surrounds recessed in the wall, and those are also all original. That was installed in the building back in 1929. Probably the largest restoration up to this point in time has been the addition of a new power plant in the basement in January 2008, and you would definitely have to say that it spoke volumes for the old power plant that had served this building's needs for what, nearly 80 years. So that's some good quality infrastructure there. Now, here in the main lobby and in the ballroom, the floors are covered, as you see, with mosaic tile. This, again, is the original tile. I mentioned earlier there's been a couple of recent fires in the building, and the most recent, January 2008, was actually here on the mezzanine level. Excuse me. But as a result, the main lobby room suffered extensive smoke damage to the ceiling and walls, which had to be repainted. Fortunately, however, the historic paint colors have been maintained, thank you to our Pike's management. You'll notice also the beautiful covered ceiling with sunken panels, surrounded by nine small diamond-shaped panels with pendants. The multicolored design of the ceiling panels were hand-stenciled, using separate stencils for each design. They were all re-stenciled between February and May 2008. The fire protection and sprinkler system were updated in 1999 and 2000. So, miraculously, the fire was put out quickly and we are able to enjoy what we're seeing today. The light fixtures in the main lobby and in here are also original and feature unique shapes as well as red and blue glass. The use of arches throughout the room and wrought iron gate leading into the restaurant are characteristics of the Spanish Revival style. The central columns here, of which I presume were stone, are octagon shaped to echo the open ceiling, and the capitals have fan and oral shaped moldings to complement the designs on the ceiling as well. You can also see the glazed tiles used throughout the building, like was used in the water fountains and other facilities. And as a decorative door surround of the mezzanine as well. We also have ADA compliant ramps, which were added in the lobby and outside the restaurant in 1995. The divots in the floor that you'll be able to see over in this area were from a glass partition that was removed. And you can also see how the partition looked in the photograph that can be observed on the mezzanine level upstairs. Now, as I mentioned earlier, the restaurant is the main office for catering 2002, after water damage was repaired and the original chandeliers were taken down in order to be cleaned and restored. The room also had several octagon shaped columns and some pillars on the north wall with floral designs on the panels. Arch shaped designs adorned the north wall. The south wall has had windows replaced with stationary glass and sliding doors. Establishments, because always when you do, you're building a better world. Thank y'all.